He's one of Australia's rising stars of stage and screen, with a mission to break cultural stereotypes.
The way I tell stories to people, it connects with them. Suddenly, they don't see Jimi Bani as an Indigenous man telling that story. Suddenly, they're seeing Ned on stage. They connect with the story. That's how I believe I have the power as a performer to connect with people.
The next in line to take over as tribal chief of his homeland in the Torres Strait.
My father is the current chief of Wagadagam, and it's been every eldest before him, eldest son, you know, and I'm next in line. You know, my grandfather would always tell me after, you know, I'm gone, it's going to be your dad. When your dad's gone, it's going to be you.
A return to cultural law, a priority.
Most of the role now at this point in time is setting back those cultural laws. It's about identity. It's about everyone, you know, in this country know where they come from and where they belong.
What's the matter with you people? This is the most important thing that will happen to this island in 200 years.
He captured the attention of the nation playing the famous land rights campaigner Eddie Mabo, who won an historic court battle which recognised native title for Indigenous Australians.
To be offered the role of Uncle Eddie was speechless, you know. I think it's one of the most important story of Australian history. For this man to fight for his land, to be terra nullius, you know, meaning no man's land, it's such a great achievement.
Jimmy's absolutely got that leadership quality, and I think that's possibly why he was so great as Eddie Mabo, because he understood that responsibility.
The man who played Eddie Koike Mabo, actor Jimi Bani, is my guest on Living Black Conversations. Hi Jimi, and thanks very much for joining us here in Cairns on Living Black Conversations.
My pleasure. No, thanks for having me. Yeah.
How did you respond to being cast to play one of the most prominent figures in Australian history, Eddie Koike Mabo, in the telemovie Mabo?
To be offered the role of Uncle Eddie was speechless. You know, I think it's one of the most important story of Australian history. You know, that changed a lot of stuff in Australia, you know. For this man to fight for his land, to be terra nullius, meaning no man's land, it's such a great achievement, you know. And the story was, you know, always going to be told and always going to be great. And to be offered the role, to play, you know, I found that there's a lot of responsibility that I had to take on, you know.
And so, yeah, what kind of responsibility did you feel in taking on this role?
Just representative for our people, the Indigenous people of Australia, you know. I think, you know, I was just at that time in my career that I was just really prepared. And, you know, the role came to me. It was like I was just like ever ready for it. You know, being a really proud Torres Strait Islander, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander man, it's a great honour to play a man that who has changed history. And I think the responsibility for myself was make sure that I would portray and you know, go through cultural protocols right and portray him, serve him and his family, you know, well.
You talked about the cultural protocols involved. Mm. What kind of protocols did you have to, you know, follow to be able to take on this role?
Yeah, look, getting permission from Auntie Benita and the family, you know, that was the main one, from the Mabo family. For them to just say yes and they agree and accept that I would play the role. And also get acceptance from the Murray Island people as well. As soon as when you get the acceptance, everything after that will be smooth. You know, you don't have to, you know, go through any sort of people saying, you know, I don't want you to play that role or anything like that. You know, it's just smooth. And also the most important thing for myself was just to go to Murray Island and go to Uncle Koike's grave, gravesite, where he's rested in Laas, where he's from. And go there and just to be in his presence and see if it's okay that he can, you know, that I can get his blessing. You know, and I felt spiritually that I got his blessing and that had a responsibility and a role to play, to walk his path, and tell his journey.
It was one thing being chosen, it was one thing saying, hey, we want you to, play this role, but then the other side of it, which not many people were aware of, because all you see is the finished product on screen, but all the consultation process that Jimi wanted to go through to make sure that everything was right first, because it's such a massive story. It's such an important story. No man in this country, in the history of this country, the colonised country, did what Mabo did, with the five other plaintiffs. No one has changed the course of history the way that he did in, proving terra nullius is wrong or was in fact incorrect.
What was that experience like going back to Murray Island, gaining the acceptance from the the traditional owners there, and visiting Eddie Mabo's grave?
It was beautiful, Murray Island in the Torres Straits are very, it's a very powerful island, and very powerful culture as well, and spirituality on Murray Island is very strong as well, and to go back there was a must. You have to do it. And to walk, for myself as a performer, as an actor, to walk where he's from and what he fought for, to feel why he fought for that place, was very important. So that, when I'm standing in his story, I know what and why he fought for that place. And to be able to walk there and to feel it, I think that was the most important thing. And, once when you get the blessing, I was like, okay, cool, I got a story to tell.
And how much did your heritage, play in, preparing for that role?
My mother is from Darnley Island. That's the sister island for Murray Island, in the eastern part of Torres Strait. And my father is from Mobiag Island, in the near western part of Torres Strait. And the relationship I have with Uncle Koiki is ownership of land, understanding what this means to me, and I could connect with him with that. Just connection with land, connection with the sea, that's who I am. I'm a proud Torres Strait Islander, that's who he was, and I couldn't do much more. The only thing I could portray was just show this, the heart and the passion, yeah.
So your father is the tribal chief of his land. What did he say to you about the significance of playing the role, and what advice did he give you?
He was my father was the first one to get the call as soon as when I got offered the role. He was the first one. He is my father, Adi Dimple Bani. He's the tribal chief of Wagadagam, from Mabiag Island, Urpiki Gupia Draslag Mabiag. The major tribe totem is Kadal, the crocodile, so he's a very cultural man, and he is my guidance, I guess, culturally. And so he was the first one to get the call when I said, Dad, Blackfellow Films, they're offering me the role of Uncle Eddie Mabo. And he was like, okay, now this is what you have to do. Take it step by step, because this man has so much responsibility, And growing up, I was aware of it, but I wasn't sort of in tune that much. So my father had a lot to do with that in explaining, what it really meant that this man did with his team, And I was like, oh my God, this is huge.
Just knowing how huge it was and that court case, it must have been daunting for you.
Yeah. Daunting is a great word, because I was like, okay, here we go. I was a bit, I won't lie, I was a bit scared, but I was proud and I knew that I had to do something, I guess, being a performer, I was there at the right time.
What did it mean to you to actually play Eddie Koike Mabo?
It means everything to me. It's like when I was at Whopper at uni, the role I want to play is Othello, Shakespeare Othello. You know, I was like, whenever I graduate, I want to play that role. But playing Eddie Koike Mabo, I didn't even realize playing Eddie Koike Mabo smashes every other role. You know, it means everything to me. It means everything to me, you know, for my people, for our people.
And what was it like playing alongside Deborah Mailman as your wife, Anita Mabo?
Working with Deborah Mailman straight away put me up into a level where I'm in the mainstream now, you know, as an Indigenous performer. And so basically I see the relationship with myself and Deborah Mailman is that the way Eddie, Auntie Bonita was the rock for Uncle Koike in real life. That's how I saw, that's what was happening in the performing wise. Deborah Mailman was the rock. You know, she was the anchor the whole way through the performance.
I adore Jimi Bani. He's such an extraordinary actor and a really, really beautiful person. Being with him on set every day through Mabo was just such a gift. He really grabbed that role and he made it something that we're all very proud of.
Do you remember how your family and community reacted when the High Court decision was made and just how historic it was back in that time in June 1992? Because you were quite young then, you were about 10 years old.
I was, yeah, but I was aware because my grandfather, the late Adi Ephraim Bani, a linguist and a strong cultural man, was, mates with Uncle Koike. You know, he sort of, I just remember sitting around the house with him talking about it. You know, he said, what the changes will happen and what this meant at that time and how big it was. And there was a big rush in the Torres Straits, people were like, wow. You know, and it certainly did, shake a lot of stuff in the Torres Straits.
I loved Lola. I know, Bella. But what she did, you didn't have a choice.
Well, you've had an incredible rise in the industry with great roles in Mabo, The Sapphires and Redfern Now. How did the little boy from Thursday Island in the Torres Strait become an actor?
It started off in 2003. I went audition for remote area in SRAN. Susie Porter played the lead. And coming from a remote area, I was always ambitious as a kid. You know, I just needed to do stuff, growing up with, my grandfather who is just like action, 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 it was always in my blood. So I needed to get out of Torres Straits. Just so I can learn something and then come back home and teach back home. So I took up basketball. So I played state league basketball here in Cairns for a bit. And then it was about, 2002, I moved down to Cairns. And a state league team called Kuyam Pride was developed down here. Uncle Danny Mosu was involved, with the Indigenous basketball program. So I came down and played basketball for a bit from 2002, 2003.
Well, he was really working at the Ibis supermarket on Thursday Island. And it came on the radio on Saima about the auditions. And he told me years back that he wanted to be an actor. So I approached him about it and told him there's auditions happening. So yeah, and he rang and got an audition there. So that's how it came about and he got the role.
And I didn't ask Paul to move. Actually, I put up a protest.
Please don't send Paul to actors. Send me.
Oh. Yeah. Got the opportunity to do Ran. Loved it. Being in front of the camera, telling stories. And I just knew straight away, this is where I'm supposed to be. You know, so during the filming, I went to Penny Chapman and said, the producer, and said, Penny, I love this, what do I do? And Penny goes, well, all the actors have agents. I'm like, oh, okay, well, get me one then. And she's like, okay, I suggest you go study. And I'm like, huh, study? I don't want to go back to school. And she goes, no, there's drama schools that teach you the craft of acting. So I auditioned for all these drama schools, NIDA, QUT, VCA, WAPA, you know, and I accepted WAPA in Perth. Loved it. The best thing I've ever done.
Are you glad that you chose the acting over the basketball career?
Yeah. it was a bit hard for me in basketball, I guess. You know, I really wanted to get to the top, you know. I guess, you know, I left it for Nathan Jawai and Patty Mills, you know, to represent the TSI mob. It's something that was, you know, it's in our culture, you know. Storytelling is within us, you know. That's what we grow up with, you know. It's in everybody's culture, you know. It's universal, and to get the opportunity to tell stories, not only in front of the camera, but in front of stage, in front of a live audience, there's nothing like it, you know. It's like, you know, you love a good yarn. You love to sit down and listen really good yarns, but to actually perform it and affect people, you know, that's what I love. I get a rush from it.
You also played another Indigenous hero, Jandamara, who led a resistance to white rule in the Kimberley region, yep, during the 1890s. Yep. Why do you think you're drawn to playing Indigenous heroes and great, strong characters?
That's a great question, Carla. It's I believe it's in my background. My father, like I said before, the Dimple Bani is the current chief of Wagadagam, where I come from. And it's been every eldest before him, eldest son, you know, and I'm next in line. And my son Dimitri is the end of the line at the moment. And I think leadership has always been within me.
What do those responsibilities entail, being a chief?
Up in the Torres Straits, what my dad is doing at the moment is setting, going back and setting the cultural cord, setting the cultural structure, going back to initiations, you know, going back to uncle teaching the boys, aunties teaching the nieces, basically the cultural cord, the cultural law, setting that back up. Obviously, there's been a big gap. You know, when the missionaries come in 1871, stopped everything, you know, as we know, around the country, stopped, you know, everything. And most of the role now at this point in time is setting back those cultural laws. It's about identity. It's about everyone, you know, in this country know where they come from and where they belong.
He'd be a great leader, taking after his father. When time comes, I feel that he'll do good because of his leadership skills and what he's chased his goal and he's actually got it, and especially too when his father's sort of giving him advice, he's always going to his father for advice, especially with the men's stuff, and I think he'll be ready when time comes because everybody. All the people know that he's next in line anyway, so that respect will come back to him and support.
It's spiritually around the country, so when I'm going into a community, my presence is known, you know, and it's already set, the platform's already set, you know, I'm already walking it, so I can't do more than that. I think for myself, it's just, you know, continue what I do, being a leader, and hopefully set a good example for everyone, and so that when my day comes, that everyone can follow and trust my decisions.
Now, what was it like growing up in a house, I believe, of 30 people?
It was fun, you know. We've got cousins, I've got cousins everywhere, you know. It's, you know, I didn't realize at that time that, you know, we were living in one house. It was just, that was just the way, you know. It's just the way. And you know, you grow up with your cousins and, you know, with your uncles and aunties in the same house and your grandparents, you know. It's, you know, it was, He was fun, you know. Growing up with my cousins and family in one house, you know, now I see everybody separated now, you know, in their own places, or, you know, move down south, and you know, like my kids now are just, you know, seeing their cousins when there's family functions, you know, growing up was always around family.
How do you, look back on that time, you know, your life growing up on Thursday Island compared to living on the mainland now, and how do you sort of balance those two worlds, living here on the mainland, doing what you do, but also fulfilling your, you know, cultural obligations as well?
There is a great responsibility that I have to take, especially for my children, to go back home at school holidays and stuff like that. But there's also education as well. Here down south, education is very important. You know, one thing that I've learned growing up is I wasn't that in tune with school. You know, I found school boring, you know, and I missed out on a lot of stuff, you know, like like reading and stuff like that, which you know, I need to have in my profession now, you know, sight reading and all that stuff, and even speak fluent English. I think it's very important, and I want my kids to, you know, to have great education, it's very important that we have great education, so that when we go back home, we have something to bring back home. We have a profession. Either you're a doctor, lawyer, a cop, whatever. But you have a responsibility to go back to your community and to have our people at home working in the main jobs, looking after. That's all we need to do.
What does acting mean to you, and where do you see it taking you into the future?
When I was young, I'm very shy. You know, I was a very shy person. And I think what I find in acting is that I have the opportunity to express myself in characters, in other people, that I haven't had the opportunity to express myself as a young shy fella, you know? And I see acting as, you know, I have the opportunity to make someone come alive, make a character come alive, and I jump into their shoes, and that's when I can express myself, it has certainly made me more confident in as a person, as a human being.
Through acting, how do you think that racism and breaking down the barriers within our society when it comes to creating better relationships between black and white Australians, how can you affect positive change in what you do?
An example I can give you is that I'm doing, myself and Aaron doing a play, Half and Half, and the language is so rich and so, you know, heightened that having an Indigenous man standing on stage saying big, long words that is not our first language is a statement in itself. And having everyone enjoying the story and laughing, I see it is that it's just communication. The way I tell stories to people, it connects with them. Suddenly, they don't see Jimi Bani as an Indigenous man telling that story. Suddenly, they're seeing Ned on stage. Wow, they connect with Ned. They don't connect with Jimmy, they connect with Ned. They connect with the story.
I'm thinking of making my own crossword puzzle.
Do you think you're up for the task?
Can't see why not.
Cryptic?
Of course.
The cryptic is rather deep water for the novice.
Novice?
Do you consider yourself an expert?
It's a mantle I'm hoping to assume.
As a leader in the Torres Strait Islands, how important do you think it is for Indigenous Australians to be recognised in the country's constitution?
As a leader, there is a lot of responsibility. The way I see it is that I try not to see both, you know, there is two sides. I believe that if I lead by example, people will follow. It's about mindset. It's about mindset in the community. It's about changing people's mindset. That's all it is. This is an advice I got from my grandfather before he passed away. He said to me, technology will take over. Use it to our advantage, to teach language, to teach culture, to keep it alive. Don't say, we don't, you know. We don't want that. We never did that in our history. We never did that. The more you block out what's happening, because whatever happening around you will evolve. You have to go with the time, you know, and use it to our advantage. With the teaching of language. And that's what, how I see it, and that's the responsibility I have as a storyteller, is to teach language, to teach culture, to keep it alive, you know? And that's what my grandfather fought for. That's what Eddie Koikimabo fought for. That's another important role I find as a leader in coming into this industry, is that I have the power to teach and affect change.